We were having a conference about a library, and the participants didn't know what was in them. At least some of them, I was one. But I knew about one thing, which I'm going to tell you. So, but I was, it was a very, actually it was a very important event for me, and in ways that Avital knows, personally it was very important. And I took actually great pleasure in writing this paper, which is why I'm going to read it again. So the little detail that I just gave is very important for the way I begin. And I'm going to begin as I began there, because this was very much about a scene. So let me pretend I'm back in Princeton with Avital and company. That's right, you are. That's right. So, I started. How do we proceed in this speculative venture? And that is the venture of trying to talk about a library whose contents were anyway sealed for me. I approached the scene with a sure knowledge that the distinguished company of shelf stalkers gathered on the occasion will have found, by the end of that meeting, this is what I declared, any number of ways to penetrate without penetrating the sealed space of that library, and will have turned its space inside out in more than one way, if only by following the topologies of the library that Derrida explored for us and also wrote for us. The topic is a beautiful one, this question of Derrida's library, and an immense one. And as I said, I'm certain that by the time we will have dispersed, we will have reached a level of speculative refinement that will allow us to announce, not without some satisfaction, that even if the crates remain sealed and nothing happens in any real sense, the library will have taken place, perhaps even found a home. For my part, though, I worried about practicing a form of bookish exercise that would amount to little more than a form of scholarship destined to fit Derrida's library, whatever its topologies, within the library or the libraries that will contain it. Can we, I asked, without opening the crates, the real ones, I mean, with their wood and their bubble wrap, can we unleash the chaos of memories that Benjamin evoked at the beginning of his magnificent little essay on collecting, and thereby the element from which a surprise or a discovery might come? Certainly, we can expect from various meditations on the book or the library that Derrida left to us in published form, important new insights or even revelations about the idea of this archive in becoming, and these could offer a properly deconstructive challenge to the libraries that will house his collection, making any notion of a home for this library, in fact, quite problematic. But I'm sure that I, like others, would remain wistful if I didn't learn something more about Derrida's collection than might be gleaned from his writings or those of others on the topic of the book, the library, or the archive. It's not so much that I want to learn more about the actual treasures Derrida might have kept at home, which we might gather from a list of the books, or ideally even their exhibition, which would also offer a precious overlay of markings and comments that we could bring to the published writings and secretly enjoy, or perhaps rue. It would be fun to know all of this, of course, and surely very instructive. But the question that motivated me and continues to urge me, bears more on Jacques Derrida's relation to this collection. And what I would be seeking are hints about a dimension of this relation that Derrida could not have mastered in his understanding of the library he kept or the one he sought to write. I will end up calling this the facticity of the collection, and I believe that if we can approach this, we may be able to learn a little bit more about what Derrida has given us to read and to think in the presence of the book that we keep chez soi, at home. My title, I should have mentioned at starting, is The Library at Home. So my question is, what is it to keep a library at home? My own effort to approach this dimension of Derrida's library will pass by what is, in fact, the only knowledge of it I have ever had, and which concerns a book that went missing from it, for a time at least, a book whose absence he felt keenly and was thus quite precious to him, in short, a rare book. So, in the spirit of Benjamin, I will tell a story about this book, in due course anyway, in order to pose a question about what the term rare might have meant to Jacques Derrida. To suggest what I'm seeking and to give my question a bit more precision, let me begin by evoking one of those scenes of reading that Derrida unfolded for us so beautifully. Indeed, for me, it is the most beautiful one. It is the scene of Mallarmé reading Pierrot, Assassin de sa femme, recounted by Mallarmé in his little text, Mimique. Many of you will be familiar with that scene and will recall the history of Mimique itself, a history that is not without pertinence for the question I want to pose. But for reasons of economy, let me simply cite the opening sentence of the first version, which was published in La Revue Indépendante of November 1886. It reads as follows. I quote, "A type of luxury," this is Mallarmé writing in this little brochure, "a type of luxury not inferior to any gala seems to me, during this treacherous season filled with its calls to go out, the setting aside under the first lamp of an evening at home for readings. The suggestive and truly rare booklet that opens in my hands is none other, in sum, than a pantomime booklet, Pierrot, Murderer of His Wife." End quote. So, nothing more enticing than reading at home under the first lamp in our treacherous season, nothing more delicious, nothing more exciting. Derrida would have enjoyed citing this scene, I'm sure, no less than he delighted in pursuing the marvelous analysis to follow that brought into question the real basis of the scene Mallarmé presents to us, including the status of the rare booklet in question. These precious pages unfold masterfully the full theater of Mallarmé's little textual production and what he called its milieu pur de fiction. And it becomes quite clear from the course of the analysis Derrida's and the textual documentation it includes why, in Derrida's eyes, the booklet should have been termed rare, rare. For the text in question, he said, programmed its own effacement. I quote, "It is therefore in a booklet on the page that Mallarmé would have read the effacement of the booklet before the gestural initiation of the mime. What Mallarmé therefore read in the text is a prescription effacing itself of itself." Now, for those who don't know this text, what he's talking about is this is the script for a mime's performance, and the script is saying, you will improvise your performance. So the text is effacing itself, supposedly, as he's reading it. "Vraiment rare," Mallarmé writes of the booklet, and we could say the same of Derrida's interpretation, which is utterly masterful. But I can't help but pause over the scene and ask whether this word, rare, rare, which Derrida underscores with Mallarmé, does not bear a more common meaning that would have been familiar to the Derrida who enjoyed books at home. And I'm wondering whether we might not be able to move from a consideration of this domestic scene to a broader consideration of the relation between a particular copy or edition and those textual operations or readings for which it might serve as an exemplar. Mimique, Derrida declared, is exemplary of a certain displacement of the order of reference or truth that occurs in and as writing. And I quote him here, "For this redoubling of the mark, which is at once a rupture and generalization that are formal, the text of Mallarmé and singularly the page before your eyes would be exemplary." Now my question is a bit more crude in relation to that last citation, far too reductive, but it's the following. What more might be said about the rarity of the exemplaire, or what Benjamin described more generally as its fate? What is its significance for the scene of reading Derrida offers via Mallarmé, that special pleasure of reading in one's library at home? Books at home. The question of Derrida's library had already begun to preoccupy me when I sat down almost 2 years ago now, to prepare a few words on Heidegger's essay from 1938, The Age of the World Picture. And so I was quite taken when I encountered again Heidegger's brief evocation of the figure of the erudite scholar from the disciplines of the humanities, that dweller of libraries and collections whose fate is sealed in the context of the accelerating activity of what counts as scientific research, which is beginning to take possession, Heidegger says, of its modern essence. These are pretty striking pages from 1938 about what the future of the university is becoming. The betrieb, the activity of science, drives the scholar from his home and any illusion such a scholar might have maintained about being at home in the university, which is finding a new configuration in research institutes and professional schools, all in the service of the common good and in what Heidegger calls the public anonymity of work that is useful to society, what in the UK is termed social impact. Here is the reference to the scholar that caught my eye. I quote from Heidegger then. On the foundation of their character as an ongoing activity, the sciences are creating for themselves the solidarity and unity appropriate to them. Hence, the decisive development of the modern character of science as ongoing activity also forms men of a different stamp. The scholar disappears. He is succeeded by the research man, who is engaged in research projects. These, rather than cultivating of erudition, lend to his work an atmosphere of incisiveness. The research man no longer needs a library at home. Moreover, he is constantly on the move. He negotiates at meetings and collects information at congresses. So that's Heidegger in 1938. The rhetorical construction of the context for this brief appearance of this nearly defunct scholar is fairly evident and even typed in its way. The scholar who dwells in the solitude of his library at home is contrasted with that uprooted type of being who pursues his activity in the bustle of professional meetings and attends to his commercial viability in negotiations with publishers. This form of activity and communication is entirely mediated, of course, by the scene in which the researcher communicates and trades his or her work. The form of exposure this individual seeks could thus not be more different from that figure, from that sought by the solitary scholar who dwells with his books at home, behind whose figure I suspect we may find Heidegger himself. Because while the scholar may work in a form of retreat, this removal for Heidegger would be the condition of a true exposure to the world or region in which that home is situated. I read into the text with these last words, but I do so because I cannot but hear behind the pitying tones of the evocation of the scholar in this essay of 1938 an echo of Heidegger's description of his own work world from 4 years prior in a brief text that is a masterpiece of denial and ideological flight, but which is also not without interest for what it says about the nature of the philosophical work that Heidegger pursued in what he considered his proper home, which he identifies as a cabin in the Black Forest. As we read in this text of 1934, which bears the title, Why I Stay in the Provinces, I quote, "My whole work is sustained and guided by the world of these mountains and their people. Lately, from time to time, my work up there is interrupted for long stretches by conferences, lecture trips, committee meetings, and my teaching work down here in Freiburg," end quote. Apparently, the rectorship consisted of a few committee meetings, and teaching proved to be a distraction. He then goes on to explain that when he retreats to his cabin, he immediately regains the fundamental rhythms of his work, enjoying a solitude that should never be confused with loneliness. I quote, "One can never be in solitude there. Solitude has the peculiar and original power not of isolating us, but of projecting our whole existence out into the vast nearness of the essence of all things." The point was also made earlier in the text. Again, I quote, "It is the work alone that opens up space for the reality that is in these mountains. The course of the work remains embedded in what happens in the region," end quote. Now, I believe we hear in these words a significant echo of the meditation on work that Heidegger was pursuing in 1934 and 35, and his notion that a work worthy of the name makes space for the environing reality, even as it embeds itself in it. That's the argument of the origin of the work of art, as you'll remember. Entering the rhythms of his work and the peculiar solitude this brings, this scholar-thinker is exposed, as he says, to the vast nearness of the essence of things and draws forth that nearness while serving the fidelity of those of the neighborhood who live near, something that Heidegger apparently couldn't find in his students or colleagues at that moment in Freiburg. So the researcher, as Heidegger tells us in 1938, then, logs miles and conference appearances, jostling for a place on the public stage, while the scholar stays close to his or her books, defining the meaning of being at home or dwelling from the library, taking the measure of his time not by staying current in relation to political affairs or academic ones, not to mention academic politics, but with respect to what Hölderlin named in the poem with which the essay of 1938 ends, the year of peoples. That's the timeline in which he's working. The modes of life and the economies could not be more profoundly different between the research man and the scholar. And once again, it seems we are to think the meaning of home from this relation to the work of thought and from the relation to the library. Now, we could pause here to consider the figure that Derrida himself cut as one who kept a library at home, with all this means for his own economies of work, while pursuing an academic career of what we might even call gigantic proportions, to draw on a very charged term from Heidegger's own essay. His extraordinary career as a teacher, writer, and then representative of his own monumental activity, and does this still belong to scholarship? This career is worthy of real attention in the light of what the institutions he traversed and in some cases helped to found are becoming. Derrida taught us, perhaps like no other, and he certainly taught me this, to be attentive to academic institutions. And the questions raised by the little issue of his library offer us a significant lever for approaching the institutional transformations he confronted and even introduced by his work on so many fronts. But here, I want to push a bit farther with the question of the library at home as Heidegger gives it to us. Because it is quite striking to me that Heidegger underscores that the now antiquated scholar is one who needs a library at home. Would it not have sufficed to say that this quaint figure needs a library where he might be at home? Apparently not. The library that serves the thinking scholar must be at home, even as it provides essential materials for determining what it means to be at home. What could the insistence on home evoke here, other than a reference to a form of rootedness, offering a confirmation of Levinas's charge of the importance of this commitment for Heidegger? The books that help define the meaning of being at home should be, once again, at home. But they do nonetheless aid the work of defining this meaning, and they do so, we may presume, this is the Heidegger of 1938, because they are works of language, which Heidegger will shortly call, as you know, the house of being. To state this more precisely, the work to be undertaken is in and with language. That is to say, in the proximity of particular configurations of language, particular works that Heidegger would have named, of course, great works. Heidegger will tell us in the course of his thinking on language that the neighborhood in which the thinking scholar works is defined, first of all, by the region of poetry and thought, their Gegend region. It is from that space of counterplay, as you will remember, that we can first begin to hear what speaks in language when it gives itself in its essence as language. And thus, we can thus first begin to meditate on the way by which our relation to that essence might be brought forth in all its strangeness. From that strangeness, as Heidegger would say in his essays on language, we could perhaps discover the human share in the historial destiny that is technique, and thereby find access to another relation to technique itself, an access Hölderlin had offered in his testimony regarding the essence of poetry. Many of you will be familiar with this line of thinking. I recall it simply because I want to underscore that the point of working with books at home is to join another temporality and another relation to beings in the nearness of the essence of language. But what about the books themselves? In the 1934 essay, Heidegger merely says that he is working at concepts in a manner that is intimately related to that of a peasant who prepares shingles for his roof. I'm not joking. Apparently, the scholar at home is working on shelter in 1934. In 1938, the books implicitly appear via mention of the library, but only in as much as they are the property of the dying type that we saw. But of course, if philosophical work entails working the neighborhood of poetry and thought, then there must be books in the hut or the home. So my question is, what kind of books would the thinker or scholar's library hold? Great works, Heidegger would say again. I'm quoting from The Origin of the Work of Art. Of course, but how would they present themselves to him or to someone unpacking his library? Would that library simply contain trustworthy editions for the handicraft of thinking? Or would there also be some volumes of a special rarity? Let me try to drive this question home with an anecdote, a personal one this time, and let me take a phrase that was dear to Heidegger and not unrelated to our topic. Poetically, man dwells. The phrase comes from Hölderlin's In liebliche Bläue, In Lovely Blueness, which is a poem assigned to the time of Hölderlin's madness, even though its real provenance is quite obscure since no manuscript exists. The poem exists, in fact, only in the novel Phaeton by Wilhelm Weiblinger, which was first published in 1823, where it is offered in prose form. Weiblinger mentions in his diary in 1822 that he had access to Hölderlin's unpublished works, and in the novel, his narrator tells us that he has taken this text from a mad poet's papers, noting that it was originally, as he says, in verses in the Pindaric manner. Who could this have been but Hölderlin? But the poem exists only in that presentation. And whatever we might presume about the textual editing involved, we have to accept that its appearance in Phaeton represents a first edition in the strongest possible sense of the term. I have no idea what Heidegger might have experienced if he actually held that book. But I can tell you, and here I allow myself one of those memories that Benjamin indulges in, I can tell you that when I held it in a library in Strasbourg in 1980, the experience was almost overwhelming. I won't indulge in more narration than to note that I have never felt closer to Hölderlin than when I read those words in that book. That encounter will always be with me, though I have to acknowledge that the nature of the encounter is extremely problematic. What was I reading but a kind of residue of the poet's effacement, a trace of his passage into madness, given in a prosaic transcription of his verse by another hand altogether? But my relation to Hölderlin was sealed by that experience, and I've been searching for a copy of that book ever since. So there's an absolute first edition, I think, in this case. Heidegger, as you'll know, was quite preoccupied with the effacement of the poet, but he records nothing like my experience, to my knowledge. In fact, we have something quite different that appears in the latter part of the 1934-35 lectures, and that only makes the question I am trying to pose more difficult. It comes in the course of his commentary on Hölderlin's poem, Vivan am Feiertage, as on a holiday, and I'm inclined to read it as a special scene of reading that is pertinent for us because of the peculiar exhilaration that marks the words. Here, Heidegger declares that what happens in the poetic saying must not be read as figural in any sense that poetics could define. Even more, it cannot be read at all as long as we remain within the realm of representation, or for that matter, reproduction. The poem inhabits the core of the German language, he declares, and can be read only in and as the event of a certain overflowing that occurs in that language. This is what Derrida might have called a débordement. And Heidegger writes, I quote, "To our initial and habitual view, this saying is admittedly just a poem, printed, copied on many pages, something that can be read here or there. All this is an illusion, and indeed a necessary illusion of being itself, of the saying that is said here, said and yet stands unsaid among the people. This saying is not something merely at hand in their libraries or their bookstores or printing shops, but is right in the innermost midst of their language, in that language that is only a shell of communication and veiling, and can be such only because it is the core of historical Dasein, that language which each day in the depth of its flowing can splash over and roar over its own saying only because in what is concealed it remains a river in which and as which being founds itself." So Heidegger is declaring that first editions don't matter. That's not the point, right? It's not about the reprinting, reproduction. Elsewhere, in his essay in Erläuterungen, his book of explications on Hölderlin, he will say that this poem that he's talking about, Vivan am Feiertage, constitutes a kind of original scene in Hölderlin's work, since from this time forward, his poetry is a primordial calling, a foundational saying that says the holy. But Heidegger will not pause to speak of the experience by which he himself came to live in the proximity of this poem. There is nothing at all about his relation to a particular edition. Again, Heidegger would seem to suggest that we can begin to think the home, or at least the meaning of dwelling, from the saying inscribed in this poem, but no library could finally contain its flow or its overflowing. If I pass now to Derrida with an eye to the question of his library at home, taking up what little I know about Derrida's interest in collecting books, you may reach the unfortunate conclusion that I am somehow bringing into question Derrida's own position in relation to his critique of the nexus of values he reads in Heidegger's work concerning the home, its economies, the proper, and what is properly one's home. You might surmise that I'm seeking to turn this critique against Derrida himself, especially after I just showed that Heidegger could care less about first editions. Right? But that would be to miss what I'm attempting here, which is to attend a bit more closely to what Derrida says regarding inscription, recitation, and the economies of desire that form in relation to the written artifact. The fact is, I know nothing at all about Heidegger's personal relation to manuscripts, Aufgabe letzter Hand, surviving copies, and so forth. His writings on language effectively turn us away from this question, and as for his personal investments, well, that's a bit more detail than I need or want to know. Derrida, on the other hand, makes the question of the edition an interesting one, and makes his own personal investments part of the question. To illustrate what I mean here, let me point to a statement that comes from his essay on Blanchot, Survivre. The words I will cite follow Derrida's own very long citation of the famous passage from the second half of Death Sentence, the scene in which the narrator discovers that a key he guards on his person has gone missing. You'll remember, if you've read this text, that the key is du genre Yale. It's a Yale key, which is something Jacques particularly enjoyed. The narrator, you will recall, proceeds to force his way into a room so familiar to him, it's a room in which he keeps books, that he claims it holds his very life, his most intimate being. It is more than an intimate space, in fact. He has brought to this room, he tells us, a life that is more than life, and knows there its touch and its gaze in a form of absolute intimacy. Of course, this space has now been violated, his key went missing, and upon entering it, with a step that will be familiar to readers of Blanchot's récit, he meets a foreign presence and goes to its encounter. It is now a frozen space, whose element is fear, and in assistance to this other, he finds there, who suffers a mortal cold, he calls, the narrator calls, come, viens, only to lose the one who has briefly figured in the guise of a kind of Eurydice. Derrida's citation of this passage takes four full pages, and it is immediately followed by the paragraph I will now cite, which is on the topic of citation and is offered in parentheses to mark, apparently, the intervention of Derrida himself in what is a kind of personal aside bearing on his relation to the text. So I quote, it's in parentheses, to cite, not to cite, it is always equally unjustifiable with respect to the law that interests me here. This is a question of economy. How can one let a text live? Must one, and in what way, take it, le prendre, or simply brush against it, say, come to it? Does one not always do this at home? That is to say, according to the violent law of one's economy, in this case my own. But we have just seen how the being at home of a room, the proper of an economy, is committed to the anonymous, divides and submits itself to the other that awaited it there, already without waiting for it. And how he then said, I remained, then I stopped again, and as he concludes, the rest has just been read. So, apparently, if you've heard, that's a difficult passage, but as you saw, he asks, is this not our relation to books at home? Apparently, we have a little indication about Derrida's relation with his books at home. And I say books here rather than texts, as you might expect, because every time I hear the erotic overtones in Derrida's descriptions of the reading relation, I'm sent back to his book on his essay on Mallarmé, La Double Séance. And the library, it seems, is a space that would be intact, according to a certain economy of desire, were that sanctum not already open to the other, always dispossessing the owner, by name anyway, in its invitation to an other that will have been waiting, without waiting, in a time and space that cannot be contained by any memory. A proper library, a surviving or living library, the library that is truly chez soi, always hosts in at least one book some other, something other that undoes the possessor's hold and undoubtedly drives to a new recitation of the invitation that introduced the book to the library in the first place. Of course, recitation of the invitation, however triumphal, commits the economy of this library chez soi to a constant displacement. But even still, would one not desire to possess the book in one's library so that it should be eternally there? I did glimpse such a desire in Derrida once, and this takes me to a further step, or back to the one in which I have been circling and which concerns the rare book. The event of the story I want to tell can be dated by the Derrida scholar because it took place during the period in which he was composing De l'Esprit. I was to have dinner with him at a restaurant near the Rue d'Ulm and arrived quite early. So early, in fact, that I had time to indulge in a special pleasure of that time, which was to visit bookshops whose holdings normally exceeded my little economy. I discovered that in such bookshops, these really fancy ones, one must be prepared to say what kind of thing one is looking for. So in response to the bookseller's inevitable inquiry, I would say works of Blanchot, and specifically the first edition of Thomas l'Obscur, a text that was unlikely to appear at that time on any shelves, so rare was it. So this was my way of getting into the store and not being obliged to buy anything. On this day, however, to my shock and apprehension, the shopkeeper told me he had just received a copy. So I caught my breath, learned that I could just barely afford it, and walked away in a stunned state. I then proceeded to the rendezvous and there discovered Marguerite Derrida, who had been sent by Jacques to bring me back to their house, because he had not wanted to leave his writing. He was feeling quite inspired, it seems. And I hesitate to say more than usual because I've always had the suspicion that he was always in that state. So, in the car, in the course of a delightful conversation on the topic of the analyst's peculiar manner of listening, Marguerite asked me what I was holding in my hands. And suddenly it flashed through my mind that I was on my way to a French household for dinner, and not just any household, without a gift. Of course, I told Marguerite my little story about the bookstore, and she laughed with delight. Responding that Jacques had just been forced to return a copy of that very book, which he had borrowed, to its owner. He had been certain, Marguerite told me, that the owner had forgotten about it and was most distressed that he had to return it. Jacques will be very jealous, she told me. Needless to say, I was feeling some confusion. We entered the house, and immediately Marguerite called out to Jacques, he was in his library, telling him that we'd arrive and he'd never believe what I was carrying. To be brief, let me simply tell you that Jacques recounted the story of his frustration at having to return the book just a couple weeks earlier two more times at that dinner, and with as much insistence as self-deprecating humor. You'll ask what I did in the face of this playful assault by the one who had introduced me to Blanchot and whom I considered my teacher. The answer, in short, is that I kept the book. Some people cheer. I can't even begin to enter the feelings and reasonings that agitated my spirit that evening. But I do recall two things that predominated in my mind. First was the thought, the realization, that Jacques was a collector. In a sense, you'll remember that is quite specifically described by Benjamin. I refer to his remarks about borrowing books without returning them. That's what defines a collector, one of the things that defines a collector. This didn't fit my sense of Jacques Derrida's relation to texts at all. Didn't he move through books like a sometimes ravaging or sometimes playful and loving spirit who could never be contained or preoccupied by any of them? I can barely represent for myself the young scholar I was, but of course I was very naive at the time. My second thought was that if I gave him the book, I would betray my own relation to it, which was just coming into being, failing both the book and myself, and even in some complicated respect, him. I had not bought the book as a collector, but in some more obscure commitment that I had yet to define. I believe I could have loaned it without a second thought, even having just learned, what kind of delinquent borrower Jacques might be. And there's a topic for those who must truly unpack Derrida's library. Just how many books will have to be returned? Or, as they say in museums, repatriated with certain legal actions. But I couldn't simply give it away, having held it for no more than a couple hours. And was that whole display, with its playful admissions, not meant to release me from the obligation? However that may be, I didn't render the book to my teacher. Instead, I sent him a painting by Salvatore Puglia a few days later, which I thought he might enjoy. As economies go, it was, as you see, a very fraught and expensive episode. I'll come back to my decision to hold the book. For now, I want to concentrate on Derrida's desire for the book, this one hint that Derrida might have been a collector. Of course, I have no basis for understanding what ultimately motivated him in this one instance, let alone any others that might turn up in the library or be missing from it. I'm quite certain that it was not a matter of the book's intrinsic monetary value. No, there was something about this book, and you'll have recognized that by a curious twist of fate, I may have been holding the very book Jacques had had to return. There was something about this book or other exemplaire belonging to its edition, that triggered his acquisitive desire. So let me pause to consider what this book might have meant to Jacques Derrida. I won't pause to rehearse the various chapters of this book's history and prehistory. I don't mean this particular book, but Thomas l'Obscur in Blanchot's oeuvre, which includes a period of composition that spanned perhaps at least, I would say, 7 or 8 years, and then the reception it received by readers such as Bataille or Lacan after its publication in 1941, and then its veritable shelving by Blanchot himself, who issued a new version that was dramatically shorter than the original one, and who proceeded in subsequent years to discourage its reprinting and translation. He wouldn't let the older one be translated. And I would have translated myself had Blanchot not indicated clearly that he did not welcome such a thing. And I had made this effort through Derrida, in fact. It just didn't go anywhere, and it was clear Blanchot didn't want that. Roughly 1,000 copies were printed, so it became, in the following decades, rare and eminently collectible. Blanchot's own relation to it, as I have just described it, was strange in as much as the work that went into it laid the groundwork for the literary work and thought that would make him the forbidding figure he would become in French letters, the one Derrida would be proud to count, though with the utmost care and in preserving every distance that respect for him dictated, as a friend. It was as though Blanchot wanted the new version to mark the event that Thomas l'Obscur would be for its time, which would become, of course, Jacques Derrida's time, as though the writing of Thomas should be dated from the time of the appearance of the new version, as though the new version should efface the first or condemn it to some eternal latency. Again, Thomas l'Obscur was rare in its first version, in part because Blanchot had sought, in some measure, its effacement. But Derrida would have been quite aware, already in the 1970s, of what this first publication of a book of fiction meant for Blanchot himself, in light of the circumstances of its gestation, and for modern literature. He would have understood that the event had already occurred when it was subject to a radical editing and retranscription. If time allowed today, this would be the moment to return to Blanchot's magnificent essay, Literature and the Right to Death, which documents in its long first section the trials of the writer who must face the disappropriations that unfold from the time of the book's publication, and then goes on to explore the infinitely ambiguous character of this product of the writer's labors, an ambiguity that inheres in the very materiality of the printed word. These are beautiful pages. They're all about how the writer writes this beloved object and it's gone. You know, he loses hope. And I would want to pause to think about the temporality of these disappropriations and the reader's share in them, particularly in those cases where a book marks an event for its time. I'm tempted by this path of reflection because I cannot help but imagine that one of the motives for collecting first editions is that the collector fancies participating, in some respect, in the time of the book and its first reception. They enjoy, I presume, imagining that they have seen what the author saw, which would include his or her own effacement, when this book saw the light of day after the long labor that preceded its appearance. One might, in fact, imagine being in the place of the first reader who received the book even before the public destiny of the book began to take form, who thus attended its event, be this a virtual non-event or a possible turning or change of epoch, something undecidable in those first days. And if the book was, in fact, destined to play some extraordinary role, as Thomas l'Obscur did, if it was a matter of a true public event, then its first appearance would have been precarious, its success essentially uncertain, particularly in the case of a first publication. And this fact will have played into the material conditions of its subsequent rarity. At a certain point, the publication of a first edition is not yet an event. Such a thing could not be anticipated, and its readers participate, potentially, in its becoming so, experiencing the event for themselves, perhaps immediately, aussitôt, as Blanchot would say, or in a more deferred way. I have to imagine that Derrida would have had trouble resisting this temptation, and all the more so as this book would have marked the opening of his time as a reader and writer. Blanchot himself pointed to something like this for Derrida when he suggested that his literary work belonged to the turning of an era that would be marked by the opening of the literary work to the question of language and to the question of writing. And Blanchot used this last term in a way that could not but reference Derrida. This reference occurs in the prefatory note to L'Entretien Infini, The Infinite Conversation, but we also find it in an even more arresting form in Le Pas Au-delà. That reference, however, obliges me to push a little farther with this reflection on origins and first editions, even though my time is growing limited for such an immense topic. I want to cite here from two segments that appear in the first pages of Le Pas Au-delà, segments that could well have been given in quotation marks, since they can be read as the internal monologue of a writer seeking to come to grips with the fissure and the dispossession introduced by the act of writing. So these are words from really from the first pages of Le Pas Au-delà. From where does it come, this power of uprooting, destruction, or change in the first words written facing the sky, in the solitude of the sky, words by themselves without prospect or pretense, il, la mer. As many of you will recognize, these are the first words of Thomas L'Obscur, or very close to them. It's certainly satisfying, too satisfying, to think that by the mere fact that something like these words, il, la mer, is written, with the demand that results from them and from which they also result, that somewhere the possibility of a radical transformation is inscribed, be it for one alone, that is to say, their suppression as a personal existence, a possibility, nothing more. So that's one segment. I'm going to read one more, and you'll hear Derrida a little bit. To write as a question of writing, question that bears the writing, that bears the question, no longer allows you this relation to being, understood in the first place as tradition, order, certainty, truth, any form of taking root, this relation to being that you received one day from the past of the world, domain that you had been called upon to govern in order to strengthen yourself, although this was as a fissured since the day when the sky opened upon its void. I will try in vain to represent him to myself, he who I was not and who, without wanting to, began to write, writing and knowing it then in such a way that the pure product of doing nothing was introduced into the world and into his world. That happened at night. During the day, there were the daytime acts, the day-to-day words, the day-to-day writing, affirmations, values, habits, nothing that counted, and yet something that one had confusedly to call life. The certainty that in writing he was putting between parentheses precisely this certainty, including the certainty of himself as the subject of writing, led him slowly, the right away, into an empty space whose void, the barred zero, heraldic, in no way prevented the turns and detours of a very long process. I could go on citing these lines forever. I mean, they're absolutely gorgeous at the beginning of Le Pas Au-delà, but I just wanted you to hear what I think is the presence of Derrida in this reflection on what it is to become a writer or to experience the event of writing. So I move quickly and forego commenting on these remarkable fragments at any length. I'll simply ask how Derrida could have resisted placing himself in the position of a first reader of Thomas L'Obscur, since Blanchot had defied the event of the book, or more precisely, the event this book transcribed for the first time in published form, in what we have learned to read as Derridian terms. And how could Derrida resist wanting to possess this transcription of Blanchot's own originary scene, inasmuch as it was also an origin of sorts for him, as I want to suggest now? Was he not also in some way tempted by being the last reader, the last in line anyway, as the one who would most appropriately inherit this book and assume responsibility for it in what might be a definitive fashion? And here, for those of you who know Benjamin's essay, you'll recognize something he says about collection and inheritance. Of course, Derrida would have recognized that if this book represented some kind of legacy for him, it was an ambiguous one. Because if read and not simply collected, it would constantly subject its holder and their relation to tradition to a kind of dispossession comparable to that experienced by the writer. something worse than dispossession, in fact, a kind of uprooting and exclusion from any chez-soi, not to mention a veritable wounding. And I remind you of the chapter that features Thomas reading in his room where he's bitten by what is either a rat or a word. The text, as Derrida knew intimately, resisted the act of collection, which may be, in fact, what fueled the desire for possession that he displayed for me and what made that display so playfully self-detracting. It may be that Derrida was quite aware that reading and collecting, in the case of a book like Thomas l'Obscur, are not, in fact, compatible at all. But this made the text perhaps all the more rare. In the preface to Barrage, Derrida declared that the essays assembled in the volume, this is a book in which he puts together a bunch of essays on Blanchot, the essays assembled in the volume all belonged to what was for him a new discovery of Blanchot's fiction and its very inaccessibility. The texts that occasioned this rediscovery were fictive works that spoke or called from what he termed the other bank, l'autre rive, the shore of that gulf that separates the one from the other in their very dying, but which remains forever indefinite, like a coast wrapped in fog. Once again, the scene by the sea from the first pages of Thomas l'Obscur remained exemplary in their evocation of this indeterminacy, though an important subtext for this image of l'autre rive was also furnished by Blanchot's great essay on friendship. And again, friendship is terribly important for Derrida here. The call, Derrida affirmed in his preface, was unlocatable and unanticipatable, both topologically and temporally. But Derrida could affirm that it was returning in this new discovery because he knew in some measure how to answer it, this call from the other shore, from Blanchot. He knew how to answer it or how to read it. For Blanchot, he said, had already taught him how to do so. Whatever difficulty Derrida might have had in locating the threshold of his first discovery of Blanchot, his first steps into the waters of the text, he knew that Blanchot had been there guiding him, just as he would be waiting for him as he followed the long course of this immersive rediscovery. And I quote now from Barrage, "If there were some pertinence in praising him, if this did not entail some crude attribution of mastery, and if le pas au-delà did not deaden such a metaphor in advance, I would say that never, as much as today, have I imagined him so far before us, waiting for us, still to come, to read, to reread by those who have been doing so since they have known how to read, and thanks to him. Don't be in a hurry to refuse this word. Read what he has to say about it, Blanchot, about grace and chance at the beginning of le pas au-delà." End quote. Now, I can't know whether Thomas l'Obscur, in its first edition, was the book by which Jacques Derrida learned to read a text like Thomas l'Obscur. Nor could Jacques, I believe. But the debt, as we have just heard, took a very singular form and was obviously immense. If he learned to read it only in rediscovering it, this book would have remained for him as something to which he owed a singular responsibility. And Derrida, the great reader and thinker that he was capable of recognizing and honoring such a relation. This was a responsibility, Derrida explains, to Blanchot himself, whose call to him had come in the second person singular. If we follow the reference to grace and chance from the lines I have just cited, we find some remarkable sentences on the nature of the gift that a teaching and writing would constitute to the extent that it gives to read. And I quote again now, this is, I think, the last citation from Blanchot. "But is grace not always the gift made by someone, a gift that is unique and of the unique? Would it not have the trait of being grace only through the memory of its origin, through the personal and always revocable relation lived as fugitive and fortunate with the power of giving? The law says, despite you, a tutoiement, I'm saying to you, that indicates no one. Grace says, without you, sans toi, without your being of any account, and as though in your absence. But this tutoiement, which seems to designate no more than the lack of anyone, restores the intimacy and singularity of the relation." I know that's a very hard passage, but I think I've indicated clearly enough by now, following this, that I've been hesitating on the question as to whether the relation granted by a book such as Thomas l'Obscur is finally compatible with the impulse to collect, taken in a strict sense. I've been hesitating about this and cannot resolve it. But let me affirm that the responsibility confirmed by such a relation was perhaps brought by every volume that Derrida would have sought to take into his personal library, and that such a relation helps constitute the very meaning of personal library, which may be different from a collection. Of course, the volume carrying this relation would be marked by a strange facticity, a material insistence that could never be fully collected, inasmuch as the intimacy and singularity of this relation would always haunt it, rendering the printed words forever indicative of an origin of meaning that was always still to come, and a responsibility requiring a kind of eternal recall. The books of a personal library in this sense could never be part of a collection. So, you will understand that I have today some rather conflicted feelings about having kept the book. Had I understood better its peculiar factical character as a thing that could never have been quite collected, and its claim on Jacques Derrida in this second person, singular, I might have chosen differently in that moment when Jacques revealed his desire to possess it. But I also believe that holding this book taught me something else about the facticity to which I am referring. Because when I kept the book, I accepted a debt and a responsibility that I could only prepare to meet by reading and writing. I wouldn't say that my debt to the two authors turned entirely on my relation to this one rare book that became irreplaceable by reason of its strange fate in my and perhaps Jacques' hands. The debt exceeded the contingencies of that episode. But I would have to acknowledge that my choice of keeping this book marked indelibly the intimacy and the singularity of my relation to them. In other words, what I had learned by their grace. And from this experience, I can't help wonder whether the personal library as such, the kind one keeps at home, close to one, is not also constituted fundamentally, if not entirely, by books of this kind. Such books need not be first editions, but they are particular books, unique exemplaires, whose facticity is determined in part by the way their fate has shaped the debts and the desires they carry. So I'm curious to know now about this rare facticity of the books in Derrida's library, knowing that such secrets are destined to effacement and may only be glimpsed like lights in the fog in their telling in that brief day of unpacking the collection so beautifully evoked by Benjamin. Thank you.